sixpence against a crooked style. Bought a crooked kitten that caught a crooked mouse, and together they lived happily in a little crooked house. I met a crooked man, crooked for he could not see, and yet he opened up a whole new world to me. Taught me how to build a castle with a grain of sand, and how to catch a rainbow in the palm of my hand. I met a crooked man, crooked for he could not hear, yet he could make me laugh if ever came a tear. He taught me how to sing and dance and whistle down the hall, and through these things I learned he wasn't so crooked after all. I met a crooked man, crooked for he had no shoes, only had one pair of pants, two shirts from which to choose. Yet he took me through the green grass fields with the blue skies up above, and the memory I treasure most, he taught me how to love. Crooked man, crooked mile, a crooked sixpence, crooked style, a crooked kitten, crooked mouse, together they lived happily in a little crooked house. Together they lived happily in a little crooked house.
Hello, my friend. Glad to see you made it. Because as always, we have gathered here in the name of Jesus Christ. Glory be to God, he's alive. He lives. There for past 3 months, going into their fourth month, I've been doing live stream Bible studies there on YouTube, and yet only find 3 viewers, you know, getting no support in that, and so much information out there. Why does anyone need somebody else to say, hey, know the Lord? Do you know the Lord? The fulfillment, and the fullness of the Gentiles is upon us. Has come upon the whole world. I don't think anybody on earth or in the world can escape knowledge of Jesus Christ, knowledge of God our Father. It's there. And it's only gonna get better, right? The Word of God is only going to increase. It's only going to be manifested everywhere. More and more. Until Jesus Christ is the light of the entire world. And that's the light of Christ. The life of all men. He is the resurrection, and everyone who has heard his voice has heard the resurrection. I hope you're finding this is better quality than that of the live streams. I think a lot of people are turned off by the live streams because of the poor quality. So I felt, you know, I could make these videos a little better quality, add a little music, a little better for your meal, I see it as the feeding of the beloved manna that came down from heaven, the Word of God. But now that people have heard it, is it good? Is it tasty? I mean, there are so many people who come to the Word of God, eat upon the Word of God, digest the Word of God, and they are satisfied. They find satisfaction. They find everything they've been missing, everything they need. You know? But there's something missing. I feel as though there's something missing. And if it wasn't important to God, if it wasn't important to Jesus, He would have never told us to love one another. He would have said, love me and me alone and put your trust in me and me alone, and the rest of the world has no value. It has no need for validation. It just ignore it, reject it, whatever it is. Stay away from it. Hate it. In many ways, He does say that, but there's one thing He refuses to say, and that's for us to not love one another. I think if we're going to know God, if we're going to have a relationship with Jesus Christ, with God our Father, we must have relationships and relations with one another. It must be important to God, because God said, this is the commandments I leave with you, that you would love one another, not just in the same way you would have them love you, but love one another as I have loved you. Love each other as I have commanded you. And I guess that's the lesson I need to embrace, loving people who refuse to love me. That's what Jesus commanded us to do. Love those who will not love you back. Be generous to those who will never repay you. You know, I see a great lesson there in the story of Stephen when he was stoned to death for preaching in the name of Jesus. Just before he fell asleep, right? Says he looked up into heaven and he saw the gates of heaven, they opened. And he could see Jesus standing at the right hand of God with power and with glory. And he says, Father, forgive them. Do not hold this sin against them. As they were murdering him, killing him, stoning him to death. Jesus says, forgive them, Father, for they know not what they are doing. He uses Paul, the chief of sinners, to write the gospel, to write the New Testament, most of it. Everything we have come to know about God and Jesus Christ, we came to know it because of the things Paul wrote. the chief of sinners. Yet we in our world are always trying to justify our hatred for the sinner, our disgust for those who don't love us back, who don't care for us. Why is it like that? Why is it like that? I mean, I in my life, and maybe you experienced the same thing, I don't know, but I in my life, I enjoy fellowshipping, I enjoy talking to other people, not only about my faith, but listening to them respond about their faith. I enjoy friendships. Don't you enjoy the friendships you have? Like, what do you find within the friendships you have? And what sucks is, as an adult, it seems like it's very hard to make friends. We had an elderly old man, 82 years old, Bill. Bill Carpenter came in and was, well, he came by and he's looking for a friend, right? And nobody is friends with him. Nobody has no relationships, really, I guess. I don't know. And, you know, you could tell he was a little down, a little depressed, and not feeling well. He asked if he could come into the church and do some singing. So Saturday, we opened the church to him and brought all of the stuff, and he sang, and, you know, it really took the wind out of him. He's 82 years old, and boy, it took the wind out of him. But he did sing, and we sat around, and we listened to him and gave him our undivided attention. Told him, you need a friend. Come on over, come to the church. I'm here every day, I'm all the time, and I'll be your friend. I don't have a problem fellowshipping with you, talking to you, listening to you. I'll be your friend. It was nice, he took us up on the offer. It felt good that he came in. It felt bad that it really took the wind out of him. Like, it was a great struggle for him to go back home. He was pooped. He was done. You know, he needed the rest of the day, or probably 2 days of rest from simply sitting here singing his songs. And he did all right, you know. I mean, he was 82. How many, what have you ever done when you were 82? And you could tell back in the day when he was probably young and full of vigor, he was probably really good. He was a showman. And he enjoyed it. He enjoyed our willingness to share with him that friendship. Share with him our time and our energy and devote that to him. You know? I got a heartbreaking story for you. I was there and haven't been received in any way, shape, or form or at all by the community of Christians here, really. They had a gathering on Sunday with a bunch of the churches kind of came together and put on a community service for the Easter Sunday services here in the community at the local high school. And yet we were the only church in town that wasn't officially invited at all. we're not invited in any way, shape, or form. And it was kind of disappointing. One person told us about it and said we should go check it out. And the plans were to do that, but God prevented it from happening. God kind of closed that door, and instead we did our own church. We did our own services here at the church, and we were unable to make it. Again, the Lord, our God, flat out shut that door. But I was talking to one of the pastors who was a part of putting that on, you know, and he asked me how things were going, how were things going here, and I told him, you know, if you're gonna ask, I guess I should give you an honest answer, and the honest answer is the past 2 years have been one of the greatest tests of my faith that I've ever been tested by ever in my life. It has been one giant test, a testing of who I really am and what it is I really stand for. I talked to him about what determines success. Does your acceptance, does your approval, does your validation determine my success? Is it your validation, your friendship, your fellowship that determines my success? Is it how many people sit in the pews? Does that determine my success? What determines success? Of course, he had no answers for me. Told him I don't have a friend. I only have one single friend in this town, and it's very tough when you have no friends. Do you know what it's like to have absolutely no friends, no one to turn to, no one to talk to, no one to fellowship with? Do you know what that's like? Nope. It was interesting because never once during our conversation did he ever say, you know, if you need somebody to talk to, you can talk to me. If you need a friend, I'll be your friend. Never once. Extremely judgmental here in this town, and maybe I'm equally as judgmental. And I just don't see how anyone, even if they say, I know the Lord, even if they dedicate their lives to the gospel and preaching the gospel, if they have no love, sympathy, empathy, No ability to even acknowledge what love is. It's void of the Holy Spirit. Because, see, God is love. And if God is love, then the Holy Spirit is a spirit of gentleness. It's a spirit of kindness. It is not rude. It's not rash. You know, love is patient. Love doesn't rejoice in wrongdoing. Instead, it rejoices in the truth. Love is gentle. Love believes all things. Love endures all things. Love will never fail. But it's interesting how void of love people have become. And not saying everybody is void of love, but One of the main reasons people have fallen away from the church and refused to come to church is because it's the last place on earth to find love. Find judgment. Find the conceited. I can find hypocrisy. But you can't really find love. It's sad, it's disappointing. You know, that's what I have always come to find and learn through the teachings of Jesus Christ, that his disciples, and this is how you know you can put your faith and your trust into the people of God, because his disciples are going to be known by the way they love one another. They have empathy for each other. They have sympathy for each other. They are able to show one another mercy. They're able to create sustainable relationships with one another because they sincerely care for each other. And you know, if we can't love our neighbors, if we can't love a stranger in the way God has asked us to love, why is it we can't love another Christian in the way God has asked us to love? So it's true, if we're not faithful with the very least, if we're not good stewards with the very smallest, what makes us think God would ever allow us to be faithful or good stewards over something important? Something that truly mattered. We are to love not only ourselves, the body of Christ, Christians, but we are to love the sojourner and the stranger, all the same. There's not one set of weights for how we engage in life with this group, or one set of weights in how we engage with this group. We are to have equal weights. We are to love one another just as Christ has loved us. And, you know, that's the answer, love. Love is always the answer, and all I can do is what God has asked me to do. That's what you can do. All you can do is ask God, or do what God has asked you to do. We can't do more. And so, what makes us successful? What determines success? I don't know. When I think of Noah and how the whole world was destined to be destroyed because it was violent, because it was in a place of unbelief, because it was a world full of abuse and hatred and division. God found Noah righteous, one man in all the world, in all of the world that was righteous. And yet, Noah being faithful to God, God saying, I'm going to destroy the world, and I'm going to destroy the violence and the hatred and the division, and I'm going to destroy everyone who's participating in it. Which was everyone but Noah. And then Noah, you know, it took him 100 years to build the ark. Nobody. Only his wife. His three sons. And their wives. 8 people in all. Climbed on that ark. Found refuge in God. Is that success? I mean, his church, the ark, was full of everything except for the fullness of humanity. What determined success? Was he successful? The only one man on earth willing to be a good steward to what God had called him to do. And that's all I can do is be a good steward to whatever God has called me to do. And I think you, in the same way, all you can do is be a good steward to whatever God has called you to do. And is that success? It's interesting. How do you start a church, right? From scratch. your faith in your calling. That's what you got. And that's the foundation of it. Nothing else. No one else out there. And although you desire the support, you desire the help, you desire an assistant pastor, you desire assistance, you desire a worship team, you desire fellowship and people to listen to you, but how do you start something from absolute scratch? The foundation of everything you're trying to start or begin or to be a part of is you and your faith in that calling. And outside of that, there is nothing. Where do you go from there? Where do you go from here? Many people have made some suggestions and pretty much followed all the suggestions the people have made. I've gone to the streets inviting people in and try again, do it again, I don't know. What is the rejection of the Holy Spirit? Jesus says it's going to be just like this. This is, and I can trust in everything Jesus says because I've experienced it in the very way Jesus said it would be experienced. And you hand out all the invitations to people to come, and no, I can't make it. One excuse after another. I have a wedding to go to. I gotta attend to my farm. I ain't got time for that. I gotta do this and I gotta do that. And we come back and say to the king, nobody is willing to come to the wedding, to the banquet. Go to the byways and to the hedges and invite those people. There's still room in here, plenty of room. And again, they have excuse after excuse of why they can't come, why they're not going to come, and is it the rejection of the Holy Spirit? And then the only people in the sanctuary, in the banquet at the wedding feast, are those who were passing out invitations. But yet God called them, and they were good stewards to what God had called them to do. Is that being successful? Makes you wonder, what determines success? I think one of the ways that's gonna create for us the success we all so desire I can, I will, I am. Strengthen us, Father, so that we can, I can do all things. I can endure all things. I can believe in all things. I can. What can I do? I can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. I can be rejected. I can be despised. I will. I will not want. I will stand in the face of my enemies, and I will not be afraid. I will walk through the shadows of the valleys of death, and I shall fear no evil. I will be led to green pastures. I will be led to quietly flowing streams. I will find comfort in our Lord's rod and his staff. I will have righteousness and goodness follow me every day of my life. I will be in the house of the Lord forever. I am capable because he is. I am okay because he is with me. I am saved because the Lord loves me. I am life because the Lord put his light in me. I am the source of goodness because God is good. I am God's beloved son. I am loved. I am protected. I am cared for. I am a witness for God. I am successful because I will do everything I can. That's our God. That's what our Father raises us to be. I can love because God said I will love. I am holy because the Lord God said I can and I will be holy, just as he is holy. Jesus said, I am the resurrection. And everyone who hears my voice and believes in me, even though he die, he will never die. Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. My sheep know my voice. They will hear me and they will respond. Jesus said, I am the vine, and you will produce fruit. Jesus said, I am the way, the life, and the truth. And no one can come to the Father unless he comes through me. Jesus said, if you love me, you'll be able to do everything I do. Nothing will be impossible for you. You will give sight to the blind. You will heal the lame, cast out demons, restore the leper. People who come to you will come to you because through you they have access to the Father. You can. You will. I am, says the Lord.
Can't help but stare how I love you. It just ain't fair.